Hello, and welcome. In today's video, we're going to showcase and discuss some emulators that might be deceiving you in some way. Whether by not delivering what they promise, blatantly copying other projects, or even stealing user data. I know not everyone will agree with everything, but I'll explain the reasons behind my choices. But first, a word from our sponsors. If you want to buy original games while saving a lot, check out Instant Gaming, the digital store that sells games for various platforms, such as PC, PlayStation, Xbox, and Nintendo Switch. Get games of all genres with discounts of up to 95%. You'll also find a variety of gift cards and credits for other services. You can pay for your order through your credit card on a website with a 4.7 rating on Trustpilot. You're buying games directly from Instant Gaming, not from other retailers. If you encounter any issues, Instant Gaming offers 24/7 support. To start, I want to give a quick disclaimer. The gameplay footage you'll see in this video was not captured using the emulators I'll be mentioning. They are purely for illustration purposes. Also, don't forget to leave a like so the video can reach more people, and if this is your first time on the channel, consider subscribing. Let's begin by talking about MyPS2. Some people might still be using this emulator on their Android devices today, but the truth is that it appeared and disappeared just as quickly. Initially, it was nothing more than a copy of NetherSX2, but with a simplified interface. Many basic features were hidden, but for the average user, it could be a game changer, making the emulator much easier to use. The lack of options on the screen also made less experienced users settle for the available features. However, just as it appeared, MyPS2 simply vanished. It received only a few updates, implementing just basic functionalities, and its last version was released in August 2024. This emulator deceived its users in a subtle way, by repackaging NetherSX2 while removing essential features like resolution scaling. In earlier versions, you couldn't even change the graphics API. Another recent project is GameFusion, which was introduced as a simplified version of WinLater. And in some ways, it fulfills that role well. However, since its early stages, people have questioned how the company behind the project would sustain an app that required such heavy investment. As of the time of writing this script, that question remains unanswered. However, just like EggNS, GameFusion is directly tied to the sale of GameSir hardware. If you own a compatible device from the brand, you can get early access to the app. The biggest concern among users is that, in the future, it may require watching ads to play games. On top of that, another issue has emerged. Google Play Protect has already flagged GameFusion as potentially collecting sensitive data, making it harder to install. This could prevent the app from reaching a more casual audience unfamiliar with emulation. While it provides a practical and accessible way to run games, I chose to uninstall it from my device after seeing Google's warning. Now, let's talk about EggNS. This emulator started off as a worse version of Skyline, where users had to watch ads to play or pay a fee. Interestingly, despite all these limitations, one of the early versions of EggNS had better compatibility than Skyline. Some games ran better on it, and it also had the advantage of automatically selecting the best turnip drivers and applying mods with a single click. However, the ad system was extremely aggressive, to the point where many users ended up paying just to get rid of it. On top of that, the emulator itself provided unauthorized access to games, keys, and firmware, raising even more concerns about the project. Another strange detail was that if you owned a specific GameSir controller, you could access the emulator without ads or fees. The downfall of EggNS happened with the release of Yuzu NCE. This emulator made every other Nintendo Switch emulator for Android obsolete, as its performance was unmatched compared to projects that still relied on JIT mode recompilers. Yuzu NCE quickly surpassed EggNS, and the project's team announced on X, formerly Twitter, that they would stop supporting version 4 of the emulator, which was based on Skyline. At the same time, they stated they were working on improvements to bring it back to the Play Store. And then came EggNS 5. But guess what? It was nothing more than an exact copy of Yuzu NCE. All the issues were identical in both projects, the compatibility list was the same, and everything worked in exactly the same way. However, no additional improvements were made, which led the community to quickly label EggNS as a fraud and abandon it. It was never proven that the emulator was used to collect user data, but its bad reputation still lingers to this day. Now I'm going to show you some evidence that was posted on the Citroen Discord and reveal what Nyushu has been doing. The first thing, when accessing the option to export or import data, there's a message with the name Citroen. When questioned about it, the response was that all emulators use the same base. In other words, they're using Citroen but didn't even bother changing the name to Nyushu. On top of that, Nyushu's welcome screen also displays the name Citroen. Looks like someone forgot to do their homework and didn't even bother to complete the rebrand. If that wasn't enough, when you open the app log, the name that appears is Yuzui. Now do you see what's happening? Yushu is like a Chernobyl megazord. They're taking code from multiple emulators and, apparently, not giving credit to anyone. At least from what I've seen, Citroen isn't mentioned anywhere. Moving on to Xionx, this emulator blatantly lies. Let's take a look at what's written on its GitHub page. Enhanced compatibility. They claim that Xionx runs most Nintendo Switch games smoothly, with no lag. Seriously? Is there any Switch emulator for Android that can actually do that? Optimized performance. They promise a flawless gaming experience. Flawless and Android in the same sentence? Come on. Even on PC, many games still have small performance issues. Customization options. This is actually true. Switch emulators do offer a good amount of customization. Regular updates. I don't follow this project closely, so if they update it, fine. User-friendly interface. This one is also valid, since Xionx is based on Yuzu, which has a pretty simple setup. Now, if you're not sitting down yet, I recommend you do, because here comes a huge lie, save state support. Let's quickly explain how save state works in emulators. For the game to return exactly to where you left off, the emulator needs to dump and store the entire RAM being used. Now, imagine Tears of the Kingdom, which on PC uses more than 16 GB of RAM. Suppose the operating system is using 4 GB. That means each save state would have to store about 12 GB of data, just to be able to load it back into memory. If you've ever used save state on RPCS3, you know that, depending on the game, the file can be 4 GB or more, and the process can take a long time. The emulator has to pack all that memory, compress it, and then reload it. Now that you know this, how long do you think your Android device would take to dump, compress, and store that insane amount of data? And how long would it take to do the reverse process? That's exactly why RPCS3 is the only modern emulator that supports this feature. And to be fair, they do an excellent job. On Android, this is impossible. Lastly, they also claim that Xionx has a supposed temperature reduction feature. This is something we don't see in Switch emulators. The work that Citroen and Sadachi did to solve this problem actually lowered temperatures, reducing from 40 degrees Celsius to around 36 to 38 degrees Celsius during gameplay. But thinking it's possible to reduce even further over time? Highly unlikely. If an average user compares emulators and reads this exaggerated description, they will definitely choose Xionx. After all, if they play badly, no problem, because Xionx is the only emulator with save state, according to them. In the end, Xionx could have been just another clone, but instead, it has to lie to users to grab a share of the popularity. But is it really worth gaining fame in such a negative way? Only the developers can answer that. Now, to wrap things up, let's talk about APS3E. Unlike the others, it's not directly scamming anyone, but just like EggNS, it uses a few tricks to keep a loyal audience, perhaps even more aggressively. It's interesting to see a project that makes PlayStation 3 emulation easier on Android, even though it's not yet ready to serve its target audience. This emulator could definitely evolve a lot in the future. However, its developer is using every possible method to make money, whether by selling paid test versions or asking for donations to continue development. We know that in some cases, money is necessary to push a project forward. But taking part of RPCS3's code and not keeping it open goes against community rules. This has already caused issues in the past, even between the Yuzu and Ryujinx teams. But the monetization of APS3E goes even further. If you've been following the project's progress and decided to support it financially, that's your right. But the big question is, what will happen when the official RPCS3 for Android is released? Will APS3E just disappear with the money from those who supported it? Or will it follow the same path as EggNS and start copying everything? Leave your opinion in the comments. And that was today's video. Thanks for watching until the end, and see you next time.